So I have a question. I've been looking into kind of some of the stuff that the early church believed, including the Nicene Creed. And recently I just bought John MacArthur's biblical systematic theology book on that. And I'm noticing that actually a view that I thought wouldn't be common is actually very common. And I'm noticing that a lot of people hold the belief of eternal generation, that the Father is communicating divine essence to the Son. I don't know what your view was on that.
Well, that's certainly the historically orthodox perspective. I'm not sure what your question about it is.
So I guess from that, because I know Scott Olson at Westminster Theological Seminary, I know he doesn't take that position, and I end up taking the position he holds, where to say that the Son is having essence being communicated to him, that means he is less of God than the Father, or he's not as divine as the Father. I'm not, like, the view for me, it sounds almost kind of weird. It sounds like a subtle heresy, I would say.
Well, well, obviously we have some miscommunication. I would be a little surprised if Dr. Oliphant didn't hold to what the Westminster Confession of Faith or the great creeds say along those lines. So it must be some type of application. And my assumption is this has something to do with the concept of eternal subordination of the Son. At least that's my guess. But the eternal subordination issue is not the same thing as the eternal generation issue. Those are not the same things. One does not lead to the other.
Right.
So
I think it might be.
Yeah. There's been a big controversy over the past couple of years about the idea of eternal subordination. But most who would hold to eternal generation would say that's one of the best ways to avoid holding to eternal subordination is to hold to that historical understanding, at least in the sense that they're wanting to avoid any type of tritheism or any capacity of subordination as to essence. Obviously, as to function in what's called the economic Trinity, you have voluntary subordination of both the Son and the Spirit to the Father in the economic Trinity. But as to the issue of the participation of the divine persons, when you realize the eternal generation does not mean a temporal thing, it is not a time thing, it is an identification thing, it is a necessary identification thing. It helps us to recognize who the Father is, who the Son is, who the Spirit is. And as long as you don't take eternal generation to the point of denying that the Son is auta theos, that he is truly God in and of himself. See, I think that's where some people maybe think that eternal generation requires you to go, is that this means that the Son is not auta theos. And some people have taken it that far. So again, that you have to figure out who you're talking about and exactly what the context is. You can hold to both the eternal generation of the Son, as well as to the idea that the Son is auta theos, that he is God in and of himself, if you just seek to remain balanced and not fall off one side or the other. I think the eternal subordination folks fall off one side of that direction. And I guess some others would argue that if you don't have an intimate personal relationship between the divine persons that's defined by eternal generation, then you can end up with tritheism. So the idea is that historic reform folks would want to, with Calvin, emphasize the fact that the Son is auta theos, while at the same time recognizing the intimate personal relationship that exists, and hence the ability to differentiate between Father, Son, and Spirit. So my guess is that that's probably what's behind what you're thinking there, is what came up about.
Right, that's actually exactly
yeah.
it.
Right.
Yeah. So what does it mean that he communicates the divine essence?
It's a relationship term. If you want, in one of the most simplistic, but I think really good illustrations, and anything that's trying to illustrate an absolute unique relationship is going to fall apart. But C.S. Lewis, who, you know, had some theological issues, but I think he had a good insight on this. C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity, if you remember the illustration he used of this, he used the relationship between two books on a table, and he says, now, if one is sitting upon the other, because of our human experience and time, we say that the one depends upon the other for its position, and we know that there was once a time when that wasn't the case. So the one is always going to be lesser than the other because it's dependent upon it. But if you take that out of time and make it something that is definitional of the relationship of those two books, then that's the illustration that he's making. See, our minds just automatically import human categories into the subject. And so when we think of generation, we think of it in time. We think of it as logical priority. And most of us don't have much of an emphasis upon understanding the need to be able to differentiate between Father, Son, and Spirit in a way that is not dependent solely upon the economic activities of the divine persons. In other words, we can see who the Father is, who the Son is, who the Spirit is because of creation and redemption and the roles that each takes and things like that. But is there any recognizable way of recognizing who Father, Son, and Spirit is in eternity past? And generation and spiration are the two terms that have been used to talk about the relationship of the divine persons before they did anything temporally in creation. So in other words, an attempt to say that you could differentiate between the persons by their relationship with one another even before they did anything, and that this then plays out in the roles that they take within creation. So it's ironic that you mentioned John MacArthur's systematic theology there, because John is one who is well known back in the 1980s, I think, to have changed his position on the issue of the relationship of the Father and the Son and related topics in regards to that particular subject. And so it's interesting that you used that. In fact, that threw me a curveball at first when you mentioned it, because I was like, well, is he going back to the 1980s thing, or just what's going on at that point too? So yeah.
So because I'm reading his systematic theology that he put together with, I forget the guy's name. And so I was thinking, oh man, more eternal subordination of the Son. Oh my gosh, I have to get away from
Yeah, this. No. You have to differentiate between those. And there's a tremendous amount of discussion of this. Actually, it's been about 2 years now about this time, all over blogs and everything else. And at the time, I was a little concerned that there was one other issue that I think is very important. And if you've read the Institutes of the Christian Religion, you know that Calvin thought was very important. And that is that we always affirm that the Son is autotheos, that he is God in and of himself. That does not require a rejection of the concept of eternal generation, as long as that is held in a balanced fashion. And I think most people have done that in the past, though there have been exceptions to that.